What comes to mind when you think about the term intellectual disability? The category of intellectual disability has been characterized by a number of different names over the years, including idiocy, feeble-mindedness, mental deficiency, and mental retardation. However, with the enactment of Rose's Law in 2010, the term used today is intellectual disability, or ID. The issue of naming or labeling has been an issue for a while. Historically, these terms preceded intellectual disability, idiocy, feeble-mindedness, and mental deficiency. These were all clinical terms that became pejorative, stigmatizing terms. For this disability condition, there's been a history of changing terminology about every 30 years. And if history is going to repeat itself, 30 years from now, someone might be talking about intellectual disability as being a pejorative term that needs to be replaced. While some sources and people in society still use the term mental retardation, we want you to understand that the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act is no longer using that term. Rose's Law was signed by President Obama in October of 2010, and that law replaces the words mental retardation with the words intellectual disability in all federal laws. The terms are synonymous in terms of their meaning. What we're talking about is a change in name, going to a less stigmatizing and more useful term. However, both terms refer to the exact same population of people. The real problem with mental retardation is that it was not used as a clinical term, but as an adjective to insult people. If someone said, "He's retarded," they were not referring to a clinical diagnosis, they were trying to insult somebody. Therefore, the term ID was put into law in an effort to help reduce the stigma associated with MR. The following is an interesting YouTube video included in this learning module that was made by a sister of a child with an intellectual disability. It does a good job of capturing the baggage that has been attached to the word retarded.
The story of my life I can't quite comprehend. Don't tell me if you know how it ends. When everywhere you go feels like a mirror maze, and you're not sure how you're stuck in this place, and you got nowhere else to go, and you're lost within your own home. And you're trying so hard to win, you keep trying, it's embarrassing. And how you don't even know, but you know you're off the tracks. And how did you get in here? Thinking, how did I get in here? I'll help you break the walls down. I'll help you break the walls down. Bust you out and take you home. Believe you me, you are not alone. I'll help you break the walls down. Does anybody know where February went? I was hoping that by now we would be the end of this. When you open up a book and read a thousand. But you don't really read, you just move your eyes. And you've got nowhere else to go, and you're lost within your own home. And you're trying so hard to win, you keep trying, it's embarrassing. And how you don't even know, but you know you're off the tracks. And how did you get in here? Thinking, how did I get in here?
You home, believe you me, you're not alone. I'll help you.
to win. You keep trying, it's embarrassing. And how you don't even know, but you know.
This definition of intellectual disability was developed by a committee that included Dr. Jim Thompson, an instructor in the Department of Special Education here at Illinois State. The definition states that ID is a disability characterized by significant limitations both in intellectual functioning and in adaptive behavior, as expressed by conceptual, social, and practical adaptive skills. This disability originates before age 18. You can see that there are three prongs to this definition: intellectual functioning, adaptive behavior, and age of onset. Because the definition incorporates age of onset, this means that ID is a developmental disability. So if the student has limits in adaptive behavior, sub-average intellectual functioning, along with age of onset prior to 18 years of age, the student could receive a diagnosis of ID. When determining eligibility for ID, the following things will be considered: limitations in present functioning, IQ test scores used to measure intellectual functioning, adaptive behaviors, and onset before age 18. IQ tests are used to measure intellectual functioning, and in order to qualify for a diagnosis of ID, the score must fall at or below 70. Tests that look at conceptual skills, social skills, and practical skills are used to determine adaptive behavior. Conceptual skills may include things such as language and literacy, money, time, number concepts, and self-direction. Social skills may include interpersonal skills, social responsibility, self-esteem, social problem solving, an ability to follow rules, obey laws, and avoid being victimized. Practical skills may include activities of daily living, occupational skills, health care, travel and transportation, schedules and routines, safety, use of money, and use of the telephone. It must also be determined that the age of onset occurred prior to the age of 18. The first prong of the definition of ID includes intelligence. Intelligence is more reflective of abstract thinking and academic processes. One thing you should realize is that it's much easier to measure intelligence than to actually define intelligence. Intelligence is most often measured by an IQ test. Let's take a look at some examples of IQ test items. An IQ test is a measure of intelligence. Today's intelligence theorists are in agreement that there are actually multiple intelligences, so IQ tests may be based on some incorrect assumptions. However, Even though the IQ represents raw mental firepower, the IQ remains the best measure we have in terms of being a reliable, valid, stable measure of a person's mental abilities. IQ tests are norm reference tests. That means people are compared to others. The purpose of the test is to compare people's intelligence to other people's intelligence. An IQ test is a measure of how you compare to all the other people who would take that same IQ test. An IQ is a measure of how you compare to all the other people who would take the same IQ test. When someone's score on an IQ test falls at least 2 standard deviations or more below the mean, or their score is 70 or below, that person could be diagnosed as a person with an intellectual disability. They must also have concurrent deficits in adaptive behavior. IQ tests produce scores that are distributed in a bell-shaped curve. The picture you are looking at is a picture of a bell curve. See how the shape of the distribution curve looks like a bell? The mean or average score on an IQ test is 100, and you can see the number 100 in the middle of the bell curve. 50% of the population scores equal to or above 100, and 50% of the population scores at or below 100. You can also see in the picture lines that go to the right and to the left of the middle line that corresponds to the score 100. Each of those lines represents a standard deviation. Once you get below 70, that is considered to be in the intellectual disability range, which includes about 2% of the population, theoretically. In reality, only about 1% of the population is diagnosed as having an intellectual disability. IQ tests can be very controversial, and so we want you to understand some important facts about them. The IQ test is not a particularly good measure of intelligence if one is trying to compare the intelligence of people in the normal range between 85 and 115. What's the difference between somebody with an IQ of 96 and somebody with an IQ of 105? There really is no difference. You cannot tell by talking to them, watching them, or having an interaction with them that they have any real differences in intelligence. What we want you to know is that the IQ test can be useful to identify people at the extreme ends of the spectrum. And so that's the usefulness of the IQ test. The second prong of the definition of ID and the cornerstone for diagnosing intellectual disability is adaptive behavior. Adaptive behavior is not a measure of ability, but rather is a measure of achievement. Adaptive behavior reflects everyday behavior, social responsibility, self-sufficiency, self-help skills, and it, of course, is based on both age and cultural expectations. The key thing for you to remember is adaptive behavior is what you can do. Adaptive behavior was added as a criteria for the diagnosis of intellectual disability way back in the 1950s. So it's over 50 years old, and its establishment is a cornerstone for diagnosing intellectual disability. It was added as a check and balance against intelligence testing. If someone scored low on an intelligence test, we would certainly want to look at their levels of achievement. If that person had a lot of street smarts, they were very self-sufficient, very independent, and they scored very high on an adaptive behavior scale, it would be a good indication that their IQ was low because of a potential lack of learning opportunities, but not a lack of mental ability. In the past, people with intellectual disabilities have been classified by their IQ scores. Classification by IQ score is not very helpful to teachers, but there are educators who still use these classification terms, and you will want to be familiar with what they mean. One category is mild or educable, and that was reserved for kids who scored in the IQ range of 55 to 70. Another classification area was moderate or trainable. That group was for children who scored in the 35 to 54 IQ range. And then severe and profound was for individuals with an IQ of 34 or below. Operationally, to get a diagnosis of intellectual disability, one needs an IQ score and an adaptive behavior score. These are the two cornerstones for diagnosis. But your textbook mentions that there is a new way of trying to understand people with intellectual disabilities by their support needs. Specifically, their needs for extra support that people from the general population do not need. The view of this approach is that intellectual disability is best understood as a state of functioning, not a trait within the person. Therefore, people with intellectual disability are people that require extraordinary supports to fully participate in school and society. This social ecological understanding of intellectual disability does not deny that people with intellectual disability have limitations. Rather, it shifts the focus from what the person's deficits are to what the person's support needs are. Such a perspective is seen by many as being far more useful and helpful than the traditional deficit orientation model. It may take some time, but eventually this conceptualization of people with intellectual disability will dominate thinking in the field of intellectual disability. At this point, developing standardized measures or objective ways to measure people by their support needs is in its infancy. However, over time, these support needs measures will get better and better, and eventually, I think we will no longer need IQ tests to make a diagnosis, but rather we can make a diagnosis on the basis of extraordinary support needs that others don't experience. The book mentions the supports intensity scale as a new scale to measure support needs. I know that you will be happy to know that the lead author of this scale is Dr. Jim Thompson, a professor in the Department of Special Education. The bottom line is that people with intellectual disability are people who require extraordinary supports to fully participate in school and society. Therefore, our focus needs to be on assessing support needs, not on assessing deficits or limitations. Prevalence of intellectual disability is influenced by age and also by degree or severity of the disability. Young children diagnosed with an intellectual disability tend to be more significantly impacted than students diagnosed during the school age years. Young children are typically diagnosed with a developmental delay rather than an intellectual disability prior to the child starting school because their development changes so rapidly. In addition, any child diagnosed before the age of 5 with intellectual disability is going to have a more severe disability and will likely have an intellectual disability that is associated with a specific syndrome, like Fragile X syndrome or Down syndrome. The school age years are typically where you find the highest incidence of intellectual disability. More people are identified with intellectual disability in terms of percentage of the population during the school years than at any other time of life. This is because during the school years, there are demands placed on people for learning, especially in terms of learning to read, write, and do math, that are not placed on them at other times of life. The group that is identified most often during school years has an IQ ranging from 55 to 70. These children are not identified prior to school and usually are not served by the adult service system after they leave school. So in one sense, their intellectual disability only lasts during the years they are in school. Of course, learning problems continue after graduation, but since our adult services oftentimes don't serve individuals with mild intellectual disability, the adult population tends to consist of people with more severe disabilities than the school population. To summarize, the preschool and adult populations have individuals with more severe limitations than the school population because most children with mild intellectual disability are only identified and served during the school years. Prevalence of intellectual disability is also influenced by gender, region, ethnicity, and socioeconomic status, or SES. There are far more males represented than females. Children from urban areas get identified more often than kids from suburban areas. In terms of ethnic overrepresentation, individuals from African American backgrounds and Latino backgrounds are more likely to get a diagnosis of intellectual disability than other ethnic groups. So how many kids are we talking about? Theoretically, it should be 2.4%. Remember the bell curve? But actually, it never is that high. Based on the report to Congress that the U.S. Department of Education publishes every year, there are 1.15% of the school-age population identified under the category of intellectual disability. That is about 8% of children with IEPs overall. So it's not the biggest disability category served under IDEA, but it's still a pretty significant disability category, about the same size as the number of kids identified with behavior disorders. What is interesting about this disability category is the variation among states in terms of prevalence rate. For example, Alabama has 2.63% of their school age population identified in this category, whereas California has less than a half of 1%. California had a lot of lawsuits for misidentification back in the 1960s and 70s, and so that established a tradition in that state to be very careful and reluctant to identify individuals with intellectual disability. My point is, you could have a child in Alabama who receives a diagnosis of intellectual disability, and they move to California, and they're the exact same child, but in California they might receive a diagnosis of learning disability. So there is some categorical drift and variation among the disability population of different states. As for Illinois, we are actually very similar to the national average. In our state, it's about 1.2% of the school population.